Is that question? To what extent I can exactly respond to your question, I'm not sure. But I think there were two parts. One was regarding the national governance and complications which arose because it was divided. In which case, presumably, and I'm afraid that's something an area in the field in which I don't know, but I gather one of my colleagues was talking about the definitions of different territories. And of course, what you're creating is a new territory, the root of the Rebanes territory, into which each of these people is actually investing in part of it. And again, to what extent this answers your question, I'm not sure, but there was at lunch an opportunity to discuss something which I, as a businesswoman who invests in things, and in a way what we do in my company is just a tiny, tiny microcosm of what you guys are creating here. Because every time we make a tour, we have to go out and look at all the component parts and decide how we're going to put it together and whether it'd be good to have a restaurant here. And you only invest a certain amount of money in it until you know you can market it. And it strikes me that there's a huge risk to invest more and more and more in something because the marketing is everything and you don't know what it is coming at the end. And I'm very interested in that dynamic. It's something which I haven't quite understood yet because this is a world which is, as it were, alien to me. But to be investing in something before you know the market is an interesting concern to me. So I just wonder whether there are limiting stages of investment along the way that you can put into
one. Independentemente de qual foi o programa que financiou neste momento a plataforma, eu gostaria de dar atenção a isso, particularmente instrumental e está. Acho que é muito importante nós, num projeto como este, não cairmos na tentação de acharmos que é um projeto que vai resolver todas as questões estruturantes do território. Um projeto desta natureza não substituiu uma política económica ativa. Por acaso, do ponto de vista, não existe por lado dos anos, não tenho nenhuma razão de dizer. Não existe e devia existir, com particular incidência neste território. Mas é essa política ativa que falta, económica, sobretudo virada para os nossos setores exportadores ou para os nossos setores que não sendo exportadores, têm uma grande importância, estão a 80% de semelhantes aqui, para o mercado nacional, por exemplo, no setor imobiliário. É essa política económica que se está ausente, não trata os problemas do reconhecimento, da adoção das pessoas, da resolução de emprego. Este é um projeto complementar, é um projeto que vai paulatinamente poder ir buscar algumas franjas das atividades tradicionais, atividades complementares, novas, digamos, utilizações, novas formas de criação da rede de emprego a partir das atividades tradicionais. Mas não é nunca um substituto com política económica ativa ou com política social. E nós não podemos cair nesse risco. Lembro-me de discutir várias vezes um projeto que estive envolvido, como sabem, estive a trabalhar e organizar o Departamento de Agricultura de Guimarães até há pouco tempo. Eu lembro-me de várias vezes discutir este assunto. A capital da Agricultura de Guimarães será, seguramente, um motor de desenvolvimento importantíssimo, mas não será nunca um substituto para o crescimento do setor global, com um grande incidente de Guimarães. Portanto, essa ideia clara, simples, tem que estar no centro muito presente, para não concluir o objetivo e, sobretudo, para não nos esquecermos, à custa destes projetos, de reclamarmos uma política económica ativa que está, de facto, ausente no nosso país.
Boa tarde, chamo-me Chico Bradley, sou museólogo, consultor, moro em Passos de Ferreira, mas vou fazer esta pergunta em inglês porque está dirigido à nossa convidada, a Dr. Rambel, de Inglaterra. The question has to do with the development of tourism over the last 50 years and the expectations of cultural tourists today, and of course has evolved from essentially a passive activity where people pass through a museum and look at pictures, or they walk through a building and they look at the walls and they receive a certain amount of information about those places. And this has begun to develop through a period what we call experiential tourism, in which the emotion that was spoken about by our guests from Spain has become paramount in many people's minds as far as what they expect from their vacation. And this has also begun to evolve even further into what we call an interactive experience, in which not only does the tourist wish to experience something above and beyond their daily life, but they wish to somehow interact or become involved in the learning process, whether it be by participating in a traditional activity or having other some sort of hands-on experience. And I'm wondering, in your experience with traveling all over the world, what can historic sites begin to offer on a regular basis for those tourists who need and require that more active, intense, and or interactive experience?
Well, I'll start by saying I think that was a wonderful summary of the voyage which tourism has made. And it's one which I've seen all the way through, from the passive to the experiential, in which case actually what it was certain people deciding how the visitors should see the site and forcing that, or at least putting that experience onto them. So neither way was quite right. And when you said it in the way you just phrased that, as interactive, I think that probably my answer to that would be very much what I was saying in my talk, which was that people want to be given all these informations and potential experiences, but just like you, me, and all the other however many people there are in this room, we would all choose different things. And if we were our grandmothers or our children, we would all choose different things. So perhaps this way of interacting is only really choice. It's choice. So that the people who go can choose how to accept the information. And the information will be through the mechanisms I spoke of, including reenactments, or, as we might have mentioned earlier, Sunday Lumiere and presentations on video. So all the mechanisms of the digital age, human guides, literature, signboards, every way that we have to offer to people to experience the site in a different way and to give them new dimensions of information we should be using, and not deciding which. So whatever we can do, starting from the bottom up, the simplest up, I would say probably, as I see it, the answer is to provide a diversity from which visitors can choose. And you prefaced your question by asking how I thought the next 50 years, is that right? Did I understand that correctly?
That'll do.
That'll do. In which case, I would say I probably don't believe it will become digitised or virtual, if that was an implication at all. I know of the site of the Vatican, for instance, which what the Spanish colleague was just talking about at the Sistine Chapel. And it is amazing. It's a very exciting thing to watch on the web. But my goodness, it is no way a substitute for going there. And nor is it any way a substitute for going there by booking the whole thing in the evening and just going with another 12 people rather than having the whole. So all these are different levels of experience. And anything which takes information and experience to more and more and more people, such as the web, is to be welcomed. That's wonderful. But the real thing, irreplaceable.